We'll start in 1 minute, actually. So we'll still give a chance to the others to join. And just one small announcement. You will need something to write, not necessarily pen and paper. For more traditional people, I would advise pen and paper, but it can be also something electronical. So just something for you to put your thoughts on more tangible elements. Okay, I think that we can start. Before we start, you will see a poll in a second, and we would like to ask you two very simple and short questions. The first, where are you from? I'm the continent. The second one, what is your experience with Kanban? So please take a few seconds to answer the question. Yes, we are almost there. Thank you very much. The majority of you, of course, comes from Americas and Europe, so hello. But we have one brave person from Australia, New Zealand. Thank you that you are with us. I really appreciate it. So let's get started. I will share my screen right now with you. And I'll be guiding you through all what we have planned for you today. So I hope everyone can see my screen. So today we'll be talking about fit for purpose framework. And we'll try to discover the true customer needs with this framework. And my name is Anya. I work for David J. Anderson School of Management. And I'm very happy to be here with you today. And I'm really happy that I can share this this time with you and this fit for purpose experiences also. So if you have any questions in the meantime, please drop them to the Q&A section of webinar. Also after the webinar, we will give you some time for your questions if you have any. So if you have ever asked yourself, how do I really know why my customers select me, my products, my services? How do I know whether a change to a product or service represents an improvement? How do I select new features, functions, classes of services? These are the main and the basic questions which fit for purpose framework will help you to answer. And just a short reminder about our brand, David J. Anderson School of Management. The essence of our brand is no wishful thinking. So what we want to show is pragmatic, actionable, and evidence-based. Evidence-based means that it was already tested, it was already introduced, implemented by a lot of people around the world. So we just provide you something what's really based on experience and empiricism. Then this is pragmatic. So we would like you to take one small piece of thing from today's webinar and make it actionable from maybe next Monday or maybe from even tomorrow. And before we even start, I have one question to you. Why are you really here? And this is a this moment when I would like to ask you, write down up to three reasons or objectives you had coming here. One, two, or three. Please write down your genuine objectives, your genuine reasons. So why are you really here? Maybe you don't have anything else to do with your evenings. Maybe you would like to learn something more. Maybe you are curious about the topic. You may have like many different reasons. Please write them down, up to three reasons, and we'll come back to them later, I promise to you. So let's take 1 minute for this exercise. Yeah, and please write down these purposes somewhere for yourself. So you can, of course, write them down in the chat. Thank you very much for that. But I would like you to also know these reasons for later, because we'll use them to show you how one of the elements of framework works in practice. Okay, the last 15 seconds. Of course, you can do it also during the webinar, so no worries. It's not an exam. Okay, so let's continue. The agenda for today. What are the key elements of a successful product? What is the true meaning of fitness criteria? How to segment your customers and how to learn your customers why? And please bear in mind that what I'll be presenting to you is pretty high level, and this is only kind of a teaser of a whole concept, which you can find in Fit for Purpose book. This is a book by David Anderson and Alexey Zhaglov. And this is the book that describes the whole framework which I will present to you today on a very high level, in some high level information and high level details. You can, of course, buy this book and read everything about it. You can also join our classes where we teach this particular framework. So the next available class is in 2 weeks, in the end of October, and the next beginning of the next year, so Q1 2021. And I hope we'll meet during one of these classes. So let's start with three components of fitness for purpose. And one more thing. What I'm presenting to you right now and what you could have seen at the beginning in the opening slide is our poster, Fit for Purpose poster, which you can download for free from our webpage, fitterforpurpose.com. I will also show you this link at the end of the presentation. You can go there, you can download this beautiful poster and enjoy this colorful piece of art whenever you want. And I will be showing to you right now the elements of this poster, talking about them shortly, what they are and how they fit into the topic of our webinar today. So we start with three components of product or service. And when we talk about fitness for purpose, I will be using the example of pizza business, because I hope that this example is pretty close to most of you or any kind of food restaurant related business. So when you think about pizza, each business has three components: design, implementation, and service delivery. So first we have design, we have the recipe. Design answers the question of what. So what we expect to see. Do we expect to see margherita, quattro formaggi, maybe Hawaiian pizza? Then implementation is how this recipe was put live. So how was this margherita pizza prepared? How was the quattro formaggio prepared? And then finally, the third element is service delivery. And this is customer's experience of consumption. And this is customer who determines fitness for purpose based on their needs and their expectations. And if you look at this lady, this is Nita. Nita is our project manager and pizza buyer. And I hope you will say hello to Nita because she will stay with us for the whole webinar. Nita is a project manager. She is working with her team of developers very long, the whole week. They are developing and delivering a product. And Friday evening, they are working very hard. And Nita decided that she wants to buy a pizza for her team. And buying pizza, she has a very particular set of needs and requirements. So she orders this pizza from Zach's Pie and Crust restaurant. And she knows that the delivery time of a pizza for this particular restaurant is 1 hour plus minus 30 minutes. So she can expect to receive this pizza between 30 and 90 minutes. Looking from non-functional quality perspective, she knows that Zach's Pie and Crust delivery nice, very tasty pizza. They are always hot and they have a lot of fancy recipes. On the other hand, from functional quality perspective, sometimes they make mistakes. So what she really wants and what she has to have is at least one veggie pizza and one gluten-free. If they make some small mistakes in the other pizzas, but they deliver veggie and gluten-free, she will be fine and happy, the same as her colleagues. And from the safety perspective, Zach's compliant with government food preparation, health and safety regulations, so she doesn't really need to worry about it. And when Nita and her team finish the work, she comes back home and we realize that Nita is not only a project manager, but she is also a working mother. So Nita comes back home and she sees her two children screaming, we are hungry. And she realizes that her fridge is almost empty and she's too tired to go to the shop, do the groceries, then come back home and spend this whole evening preparing dinner for her children, screaming children that are really hungry. So what she decides to do, she decides to order pizza for them. But this time, she has a different set of requirements, different needs. That's why she decides to choose another pizza restaurant, which is Westside Pizza. And what's the most important for her children is the delivery time. So pizza needs to be delivered in 20 minutes and no minute longer. And it must be cheese pizza. So it doesn't necessarily have to be very, very fancy, very strange new recipe. It just needs to be just pizza and it needs to be delivered in 20 minutes. And these are two main needs from Nita and her children. And when we compare these two Nitas, although this is one person looking from the demographic perspective, so demographically, she's a woman, mid-30s, living in suburban area. From the market perspective, she represents two different market segments. And when we look at her request from design, implementation, and service delivery perspective, we'll see that design for her coworkers is very important because it needs to be fancy recipe from and pizza needs to be really nice, hot, and excellent. And on the other hand, we have pizza for children, and the design is unimaginative, so they don't really care too much about it. Looking from the implementation perspective, implementation for coworkers has to be perfect. For children, mediocre, but still passable. And service delivery, coworkers can accept some small errors, like say two Hawaiian pizza except for one with salami. But children really needs to have excellent service delivery, like 20 minutes, no longer and no errors because it has to be cheese pizza. And when we summarize it, if both restaurants are able to deliver the product that meets needs of Nita as a customer, we can say that this was fit for customer purpose. And what's important to be able to measure customer satisfaction are KPIs. And we'll be talking about KPIs, but also about some other metrics, which may not be that easy to identify at the first glance. So if I asked you what metrics do you track right now, we would probably spend another day here, because every one of you at work, even at home, gathers different metrics that are supposed to help you somehow. So this is just a list of metrics that David and Alexei faced during their work and their studies about this whole concept. So you can see that even this list for two people is pretty long. And if we started to talk about it, you would probably give us much, much longer list. But the question is, by which of these metrics do your customer choose you? So which of these metrics is really important for your customers, and which of these metrics affects the customer choice? So when you think about your customers, and we look at this example of metrics, is number of bugs, defects important for your customers? Probably yes, if they don't receive their product on time because of number of defects. Is return on investment important for your customers? Does it affect their choice? Is employee satisfaction important for your customers? And you can ask the same question about any of these metrics, but the real question that you should ask is this metric affecting the customer choice and the way customer choose me and my product? And what we observe is that many businesses track lots of KPIs, key performance indicators. And you know, even me, like a few years ago when I was working in one of huge companies, I was responsible for collecting metrics, specific KPIs, and everything was KPI. And I did it for 2 years. So I spent every month, we did it every month, at the end of the month, I spent 2 days to prepare all of these KPIs. And at some point of time, we had so many KPIs that I had to have separate tracker to really see and remember all of the KPIs I need to prepare for the previous month, because there was that many of them. And what we observed that we really gathered a lot of KPIs. We measure a lot of KPIs, but our customers choose us based on relatively few fitness criteria. And most of those metrics that we call KPIs aren't really key. So what is key performance indicator? Let's look at the example of a hospital in Canada. And what this hospital struggles with is the waiting time. So this is a hospital for children, and children, patients, and their parents need to wait really long time for examination, for the treatment. And this is what really affects their satisfaction. But if we look what this hospital measures, is operating room utilization. So the level to which operating rooms were utilized, ideally 100%. But if we ask the question, will parents complain to health ministry that operating room utilization is not 100%? Does patients, these children and their parents, do they really care about it? No, they care how long they need to wait for their treatment, how long they need to wait for examination. So this is what matters to the clients of this hospital. And we see that hospitals process a solution evolves selecting wrong KPI, not the customer fitness criteria. They are measuring OR utilization, whilst they should measure the waiting time, which is important for their clients. So that's why you should select your KPIs carefully. And when you think about KPIs, look at the fitness criteria. So fitness criteria are these criteria that customers can recognize. criteria that are transparent to your customers. And for this criteria, you need to identify thresholds. So minimum performance and exceptional performance. So minimum performance is, yes, it's absolute minimum. So below this minimum, your customers will not be satisfied at all. On the other hand, there's exceptional performance, which makes your customer super happy. And what's important, why would you really bother about this exceptional performance level? Because when we make our customers super happy and we start to add something more and more to our product, and we see that it really doesn't affect our customer happiness anymore, and it doesn't bring us more customer, or it doesn't create for us additional value. So current customers don't buy more from us. It means that it doesn't make sense to really go above this exceptional performance threshold. The next metric are health indicators. So let's think about the heart rate for a moment. What if your heart rate goes way up? Or what if your heart rate goes way down? Both directions are pretty bad, and we would like to avoid our heart rate to be too high or too low. So when you think about health indicators, there is no ideal value. So there is no one number for your heart rate to achieve. You should just keep them within the healthy range. So there is a minimum and maximum heart rate for you, and this is very specifically for you, which is within the healthy range. And until this is in this range, you shouldn't worry about your health. If you start to observe that it exceeds healthy range or it's too low, it means that you should take some additional activities. And this is the same with your business. So when you measure health indicators, you should keep them in a healthy range, and any change above the healthy range, up or down, means that you should really look at this metrics and the area of business that these metrics relate to. The third metric are improvement metrics are improvement drivers. And this gentleman here, Paul O'Neill, he was head of Alcoa. And back then when he started, there were a lot of accidents in the manufacturing. So what was his goal? He pursued a zero injuries politic. And the question here was, does your decision or action move us closer to a safe workplace and our goal of zero injuries? So this is what this is one of the characteristics of improvement drivers, that they have a goal and they should drive the improvement until we reach this goal. And to summarize you these metrics and to make it clear for you, what's the difference between them? We have customer fitness criteria, which you should make your KPIs, so your key performance indicators. And these are the criteria that are transparent to your customers and which make them to choose your product. And for each segment of the market, you should have different customer fitness criteria. For this fitness criteria, you need to establish thresholds of minimal and exceptional performance. Then you have health indicators, which you shouldn't make your KPIs because they are important to your business, but customers may not even see them, and for sure they don't choose by them. And finally, you should monitor these health indicators within the healthy range. Then we have improvement drivers. Improvement drivers always have target. And you use improvement drivers on a temporary basis. So if I'm going to use again a health example, if we're talking about the weight, sorry. If we're talking about weight, there is some healthy range. So your weight is your health indicator. So your weight shouldn't go too high or too low. But what if it goes any of this direction? It actually happened to me when I gave birth to my child. My weight went dramatically low, and it wasn't very healthy. So I went to the doctor, and together with the doctor, we decided about some improvement program for my health. So then the weight was improvement driver. So I had a goal, which I had to achieve to be healthy again. So back then it was improvement driver. But when I already achieved this goal and my weight came back to the normal range for me, I transferred it to the health indicator. So this is one thing that you can do to your improvement drivers, transfer it to health indicators and keep it within healthy range. The other thing you can do when you finish improvement and you don't need this driver anymore, you can just stop measuring it because you achieved your goal. And what if your metric doesn't fall into any of these three categories? Probably this is a vanity metric. And one of the characteristics of vanity metrics is the more the merrier. So, you know, the more you achieve, the better. And giving an example from one of businesses I worked in, employees have been rewarded based on the number of emails they answered. So the more emails they answered, the more it meant, according to this metric, that they are very productive. So they've been rewarded for the number of answered emails, which started to lead to a really pathological situation when you have people, employees, sending emails to each other just to boost this number of emails answered. And there was no limit. So no one really cared that this person answered 100 emails or 200 emails over a day. No one took care for it. The only important thing was the number of emails answered. And this is how people were rewarded. So of course, probably this is one of most strange and pathological examples, but this is what you may also observe. What's difficult about the vanity metrics is that there may be some emotional connection to these metrics. So sometimes they may not be easy to remove. So you need to bear it in mind that people, especially the ones that are on the top and they are always the best, are really emotionally attached to gathering this metric. Before we go further, I see that you have questions and I see that you are raising your hands. If there are any questions to the content of this webinar, please wait for a moment. Let's park them and I will try to answer them after the webinar, if you don't mind. So market segmentation by purpose. And we really need to understand the segments of our market. And I will show you one of the techniques, which is actually the integration technique described in Fit for Purpose book. And of course, you may find many different techniques during reading the book or during the class. But the technique I will present to you, just an example, is a persona. So the definition of persona. Persona is the description of an archetypal representative of a market audience, product or service user segment. And now translating it to our beloved Nita. So you remember when I started to talk about Nita and the demographic segments she represents. From demographical perspective, she is just one person, one Nita. But when we look at her from the market perspective, she represents two different market segments. So she is on one hand, project manager and pizza buyer. And on the other hand, she is a working mom and pizza buyer. And in any of these segments, in each of these segments, she has different set of needs for her pizza order. So for Nita as project manager and pizza buyer, she really wants to receive fancy pizza, wants to see variety of gourmet recipes, it should be handmade, arrive hot, but delivery and some errors in preparing these pizzas are still okay and acceptable. On the other hand, when she is a working mom and pizza buyer, so another representative of the market, she is okay to choose only from a few basic recipes, and she can reheat this pizza in microwave. But on the other hand, she needs to have this pizza in 20 minutes, highly predictable delivery, and it must be cheese pizza. So when you can see that if you look at Nita only from the demographic perspective, you may lose this differentiation in Nita's behavior and Nita's needs. So what's really important is that you should segment your market by purpose, not by demographical categories. Because even if we have one Nita, you have two different Nitas choosing the product. So don't treat your market homogeneously. Identify your market segments by your customer purpose. And how to really start to do it? Let's create personas for pizza buyers first. And by persona, I don't mean the person, of course. Because when we think about Nita, who is a project manager and pizza buyer, let's imagine a situation that she's working late, but she really doesn't have time to gather all of these orders from her colleagues and putting the order in the pizza. So, in the restaurant. So she asks one of her colleagues, one of the developers, to do it for her, which means that right now we have, from demographic perspective, this is completely different person, because let's say now he is a man, 25 years old, no children, and living in the center of the city. But as a market representative, he's still the same representative as Nita. So you can also, and you should, build narratives around the personas, and we'll be talking more about narratives in a moment. And some handy questions to start with. Of course, the list is not exhaustive. It's just the list of some questions that you can start with, and the questions that really helped me some time ago. So start, yes, and we start actually with some demographic elements. So if you really cannot imagine persona, you can put in your head a picture of someone you know who will be good representative of this market segment. So you can choose, I don't know, any John, Kate, Lauren, or whoever from your list of friends who will be good representative of this market segment. You can give this person a name, give this person the age. You can even put a picture or draw this person on wherever you will be building this description. Where does this person live? What is he/she doing? What's his/her job? What is this persona like? Then let's go to the user scenario. So describe the rituals. What does a normal day of this persona look? How does the morning look? Noon. What are the rituals? What are the daily activities? Finally, what is his or her pain? So what are the problems he or she has coming to you? What are the problems that they bring to you? And not only the problems, also think about benefits of cooperating with you or your company. So you can start with these questions, and you will see that you will see a different representatives of the market segments very quickly. And kind of a segue to the next section is a short reminder. So customers choose intuitively by a few criteria. So don't create a endless list of metrics. Focus on the fitness criteria. And you should really understand your customer's why. And because your customer's why is one of the most important things that you need to start with. And how to understand our customer's why. Finally, we move to the section which relates to the topic of our webinar. Don't fly blind. And what does it mean? We can learn our customers' why in two ways: humans and narrative, which is flying visually, and service and data, which is flying by instruments. And we'll start with humans and narrative. So if we ask who really knows Nita's story, it's a pizza boy. So a person who delivers pizza to Nita. And let's imagine there is a Friday evening, Nita put an order, he packed this pizza, he delivers pizza to Nita. And he can see where does she live, what's her neighborhood. When she opens the door, he can see that she's living alone, or maybe she's living with her two children, or maybe she's living with her dog only. He can talk to her, and he can start to collect some information about Nita and their needs that are simply more than just placing the order for the pizza, because behind this order, there is her need and there is her story. So the ones who know the stories of our customers is our frontline staff. And we should really focus on teaching our frontline staff to learn what matters to the customers and why it matters to the customers. And we should also create ways to capture customer stories or maybe directly involve customer-facing staff when we define the customer segments and their fitness criteria. And what's said about this is that very often customer-facing staff are people who are at the lowest grade at our company, and staff turnover is very high. So if these people leave our company, these are not only people that leave, but they take with them all of our customer story. Moving to flying by instruments. Do you remember the question we started with? So why are you here? And I asked you to write down up to three reasons, three objectives, purposes you had coming to this webinar. And what you did was already the first step in our Fit for Purpose card. So what you can see here is an example of Fit for Purpose card from our training business. And what you did is exactly the first question. So here it says, tell us why you choose our offering. Select up to three. So this is what I told you. Select up to three reasons or objectives you had when choosing it. When I did this, I don't want to say survey, but when I started to introduce a Fit for Purpose card, I did it always at the beginning of my classes, of my workshops, and people were very relaxed. Yet they were drinking coffee, tea, looking at the training materials, and they were not yet biased by what happens during the class. So maybe air conditioning, maybe the content of the class, maybe the way I speak or I look, whatever, everything could distract them. So I really wanted their purposes to be genuine. So what they feel and what they have in mind when they enter the training room. And then after the class workshop is done, I ask them to fill in two other questions. So question number two is, for each reason or objective in question one, please indicate how fit for purpose you found our service in fulfilling your expectation. And we ask people to score on the scale from 0 to 5. And about the scale in a moment, you will see the details of the scale. And finally, question number three, this is a place where we ask people about narratives. So tell us why you gave the score in question two. So not only giving the score, but I would really like to understand what's behind this score. Why did you give this particular score? And this is not just our curiosity, and we don't feel it because we simply need to put it to our statistics and feel better. This Fit for Purpose card is very actionable. So what we can read from this card helps us to improve every day and helps us to better understand our customers and how our offer fits the customers and who our customers really are and what they want from us. And here is the scale. So looking at the question two in more details, scale is from 0 to 5. Where 5 says product exceeded my expectation, 4 product matched my expectations, 3 product matched most of my expectations, 2 significant amount of expectations were unmet, 1 I got some values but most of my needs are unmet, and 0 the product is not fit at all for this purpose. And we treat 5 and 4 as positive result, 3 as neutral result, and 0 to 2 as negative. But simply looking at net fitness score, we see that it's not fit for purpose. Because let's imagine two situations. We have situation one where we have 50% of positive answers and 50% of negative answers. And situation two where we have 100% of neutral answers and no positive negative answers. So our net fitness score is 0. But these are two completely different situations and they call for completely different actions. So we cannot compare these two numbers because the details behind them call for different actions. So what we do, we deliver fit for purpose box score. And that's why you always use triple. So these 3 numbers sum up into 100%. And this box score says to you that we have 74% positive answers, 23% neutral answers, 3% negative answers. And don't aggregate, always use triple. And summary of fit for purpose card and scoring. First question, what was your purpose coming here? Second, assess the fitness for that purpose using taxonomy. And tell us why. So give us a story about this scoring. And to give you some tangible example, these are examples of the segments that were identified by Alexey during his work. He identified 4 segments. So pragmatic managers, professional developers, development, certification, and office politics. And you can also see some legend to these numbers. So first of all, we have 4 columns, plus, 0, minus, and hashtag. So plus are positive, is positive scoring. So 4 and 5, 0 is neutral, which is 3. Minus is negative, 0, 1, 2. And number of answers in this segment. And you can see that our primary and target segment are pragmatic managers. And we can see that we do pretty well. 94% is positive, 6% only is negative. Then we have 2 secondary segments, which are professional development and certifications. And the last segment, office politics. So this is a collection of random purposes that we didn't really expect to see, but they are also not our target. And now what you can do with this in practice? So let's turn right now at this fit for purpose box score into action. Here you have the matrix of market segment. So is it our target or non-target segment, and fitness level, unsatisfactory, mediocre, satisfactory. So looking from 1, which is right hand side on the top, we have our target segment and we satisfy this segment. So what we want to do is to protect, encourage and grow the segment. If it's still target, but fitness level is mediocre somehow, we should look for improvements. If this is unsatisfactory, we should look for improvements or maybe consider new targets. We need to check the details behind the answers. Then looking at the bottom line, so non-target. If this is non-target and customers are not satisfied, we simply switch it off. Because these are people that don't want our service and actually we don't have anything to offer for them. If they are non-target and fitness level is mediocre, then definitely we shouldn't overserve them, potentially switch off. If they are satisfied, but they are not our target, We should really look closer at this situation, because there is a chance that we have discovered another market segment that we didn't think about. What may help us, of course, are the narratives behind the scoring. Maybe we should modify a strategy and consider some improvements. And if we try to map these four market segments that I showed you on the previous slide, we could see that our pragmatic managers are satisfied and they are our target. So we should really protect them, grow them, and really take care for them. The same with certification. People wanted to receive certification, they received certification. That's okay. In terms of personal development, we have seen some areas for improvement. So we should really work on this target market segment. And finally, office politics, they were not very satisfied and they're also not our target, so probably want to switch them off. Some tangible benefits of fit for purpose card. You don't ask anyone about recommendation of the class, so you don't want people to speculate about their future behaviors. You don't ask them, what do you think you would do in 5 days, in a month? Would you recommend us or not? No, what we do, we only ask about their experience. We ask about our customers' experience. So what they saw, what they experienced, and what do they think about this experience and our service? Customer can choose out of 6 levels and each of them is explicitly defined. So we have a taxonomy, which means that if there is a very high probability that if I give 4, my 4 is the same as your 4 because each of the levels is described. So you know what each of the levels mean. This is not simply 0 to 5 with no explanation. This is not 0 to 10. With no explanation. You know what each number means. 6 levels are psychologically optimal for people to give a meaningful answer, so we don't want to have more than 6. 6 is really fine. And it helps people to navigate in this scale from 0 to 5. If we have more than 6, it may be difficult. It may take more time to really understand what we try to achieve. And finally, question number 3. Very important and very nice question, because we ask people to tell their stories and people like to tell stories. People are storytellers. And for the trainer, it opens up a huge field of learning about the satisfaction criteria, about the threshold values for this criteria. And we may also see that we'll discover unimagined purposes previously. And as the last example, we may see that there are some segments of the market that were non-target for us, but actually we satisfy them very well. So maybe we can also discover new market segments thanks to this third question. But there are also some intangible benefits of fit for purpose cards, my very personal. So what I noticed was that people seem to be more honest, and people are more honest because you don't ask them to judge a person. So the surveys that I normally received from learning and development departments started with, how did you like the training, 0 to 10? How do you assess the trainer, 0 to 10? Okay. So then I received all of the surveys and it was like very nervous searching for 0s, 1 or even 7, because even 7 wasn't that good score. And it was very personal because people assessed me as a person. And with fit for purpose, they simply don't have to do it because we ask people about their purpose, not about how did they like the trainer. Also happened to me that I received the cards with no rating, or with the rating, but question 3 wasn't filled in. But even then, when this fit for purpose card is not filled in, it already gives you some valuable information, because even from question number 1, you can see what was the purpose for coming here. And if you don't have question 2 and 3, looking at the purpose, you can even try to analyze this question and see that actually these purposes are not the one that you were able to meet. And what I also notice is that people tend to comment the rating much easier and more often than in the standard surveys. And it also happens to me that when I receive survey and all of the questions are mandatory and there is this huge box which says, now please give us your reasoning. It's like, oh my God, I really don't want to do it. Because again, traditional surveys ask you about assessing trainer or giving some general comment about the training. And here you are asked specifically about your purpose, and people like to talk about themselves. And finally, as a trainer or as a product manager, so whoever who asks about assessing the product or service, even if you see zero or one, you don't feel bad about it. And I didn't expect it until I really see, until I have really seen these answers. And I read purposes, then I saw the score 0-1. It was like, oh, at the beginning. But then I read the question, the question number 3 and the narrative. And again, there was no judgment. So fit for purpose card helps you to be safe. It doesn't ask anyone for judgment. It just asks you about your purpose. So now, when you know that much about fit for purpose card, the second part of the exercise, please finalize your virtual fit for purpose card. So wherever you have written down your purposes, your reasons, your objectives, please write now, do question number 2 and question number 3. So first, please write this score at each of your purposes, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And here you have the scale and the taxonomy. And question number 3, please write down why you have given the score in question number 2. So please give your narratives. And let's take 2 minutes for it. And after this webinar, you will see fit for purpose cards, which I really appreciate you to fill in. And you can copy paste your purposes, the score you gave, and finally the narratives, because it helps us to create better webinars for you. We really like to know why you are here. Did we satisfy you as our clients today? And why did you give this score particularly? So let's take 2 minutes right now and we will close up the webinar. Okay, so while you are preparing your fit for purpose card, I will try to answer the questions. So the question from Slava, fit for purpose card looks totally awesome. Thank you very much. What if a person who bought the product is not the same who are using it? And how would you suggest to use a fit for purpose card? So there are some gaps, some blind spots in fit for purpose framework. And of course, we are not able to address all of them. These blind spots will be addressed in the following books to fit for purpose, so the one that is already available. So what I would do is depending on, you know, because the most important is the experience of the user. So yes, I may buy the class for someone, but then I'm not the one who attends this class. So we are looking for the purpose of our immediate client, not just intermediary in this process. So I would ask the person who consumes the product, not the person who is buying the product. And I believe that we should have, you should have possibility to do it. Question number two from Aldo. What is suggested cadence interval to repeat fit for purpose survey? How does we differentiate two surveys? Can we treat them as if it's something like campaigns? So if this is one of event, one of service like training, of course you do it only once. And I'm not pretty sure about the example you may refer to. What I'm thinking right now is a product that customer consumes regularly. So then we could think about introducing some cadence to see if the purpose for consuming this product changed. And yes, probably you could treat it as a campaign. And we have two questions from Sonia. What should we expect from the next edition of Fit for Purpose book? When do you plan to release it? Is there an online version of Fit for Purpose card? I'm not aware of one. And I have a question. Do we have David in this webinar? Okay, Lauren, probably I need some help from you. Allowed to talk. Okay, I will get it. I will get it in a second.
As I'm looking, I'm just...
Yes, I can see it. Allowed to talk. Okay, David, I allowed you to talk. I hope so. But you need to unmute. Yes.
Oh, okay.
So the question from Sonia was about the next edition of Fit for Purpose book and any plan to release it.
So there is a plan for a third edition because some modified draft, modified chapters, maybe one more new chapter that needs to be written. Realistically, it's a production project for the first quarter of next year. So maybe the spring of next year for the third edition of the current book. We've done a lot of research for the sequel, the second book in the series, the Built for Survival book, but we haven't started writing it. So realistically, it's not a 2021 project, and when exactly it might happen is hard to say.
Okay, thank you very much. One last slide from me. Thank you. Big hearts to everyone. If you have any questions, please drop me an email. You can also find me on LinkedIn. You can follow our LinkedIn pages, David J. Anderson School of Management. And you will receive all of the news from us. And yes?
I think we should mention that this poster is the third edition poster. So this is already ahead of where the book's the second edition. So this is the third edition poster, and the training class is based on the third edition content, but the third edition book It's not ready probably until the spring of next year. And this is a new poster that we released very recently, the version 3 of the poster, the third edition poster. So if you're out there and you got this poster some time ago, you may find it's the older, you have the older version. And the easy way to spot the difference is on the left-hand side, the common fitness criteria. In the old poster, there's only 3. In the new one, there's 6.
Yes, thank you very much. And you can download this poster from the web pages you have here on the screen, fitterforpurpose.com. Please go to this page, press download button, and after a few additional steps, you will get it. And one more thing, actually we didn't announce it earlier, but a surprise for you, you can use the discount code for Fit for Purpose classes. When you are buying the class, you can use the discount code F4PWebinar, written together, and you can enjoy the discount, and I hope to see you in the class very soon. And I noticed that there are a lot of questions in, not in the Q&A, but in the comment section, in the chat section, sorry. So maybe we'll work with Lauren on how to extract them. And we'll look at them. Apologies, I didn't have a chance to answer all of them because there are some comments, there are some questions, and there is also a scoring. So I need to filter them. We'll try to extract these questions, and probably we'll prepare a blog post about it, or you can see the answer over our LinkedIn page. Hopefully very soon. Okay, so that's everything from me. Thank you very much for your time. I hope you enjoyed it, and I hope we'll see very soon during our next webinar. Have a nice day, evening, night, wherever you sit, and see you.
Well done.